Hello everyone, my name is James Dodowich. I'm here at Matthew's Living Farm Museum here in Galax, Virginia. I reside in Max Meadows, Virginia. And today I'm going to be talking to you all about the history of blacksmithing, and I will be making a few small projects, a few small amenities that you would find on a typical house farm. Blacksmithing began in the Caucasus Mountains, which is located between Europe and Asia, roughly 4,000 years ago. Over time, as the techniques were being developed and perfected by the smiths, many different tools and techniques were being made and developed during this time. Moving into the early Industrial Revolution, which was around 1790s, that was when smithing slowly began to decline, but prior to that, smithing was very, very much an important trade in every village, whether it was here in the States or over in Europe. By the Industrial Revolution, it did decline, but there was still actually a demand for smithing. And by the early 1900s, smithing still was quite popular, but it had slowly started to decline. And this particular forge here and this anvil here are both prime examples of these tools still being made, sold, and used by smiths of that time. Now, by the 1920s, it was still quite prevalent to find a smith in some villages, but by the time the automobile came around, it really started to decline because nobody was using horse and buggy anymore, so a lot of the tools and techniques that would have been used to fix and repair carriages was pretty much being obsoleted by that time. And by the 1930s and 40s, smithing really started to decline by then, but again, you were still finding folks who were still doing this. Shortly after World War II, this blacksmithing really, really drastically declined. And by that time, you only had a couple of shops open here and there throughout the United States. And the few shops that did manage to survive were primarily just doing specialty work. By the 1970s, you actually had what was a renewed interest in the smithing trade, along with woodworking and some other classic trades as well at that time. So now what I'm going to talk a little bit about are some of the tools of the trade. So the anvil, most people are familiar with what an anvil looks like. But what most people don't realize is that these things are actually made, they're primarily made of steel. The older ones were made of forged steel. Some of them were cast, two pieces that you would have had, the body would have been cast of one piece of either cast iron or steel with a hardened face welded on top. This particular anvil here is forged of one solid piece of steel. When I go to use this, you will hear a high-pitched sound that you will definitely pick up on with a solid forged anvil. Now, anvils come in many different sizes. Most of them can weigh as little as a couple of pounds, and some of them can weigh as much as several hundred pounds. This one here is a modest 80 pounds, which is pretty good size. And there were many different manufacturers who made these anvils. Now, the horn of the anvil is primarily used for bending. You have the horn tapers from a smaller point up to a much wider point. So if you want to make a really, really small bend in it, you would start here. If you want to make a wider bend, you would start here. A lot of times you could actually take the end of the horn. If you were going to flare a piece of pipe for something, you would simply heat it up, place it over the horn of the anvil, and then just hit it and strike it as you're turning it. Now here, behind the horn, we have what's called the soft plate, the soft table. This is primarily where smiths would use a chisel and a hammer, and they'd bring the stock here to be split with a chisel and hammer. It normally doesn't get used very often, but it's just there. Then we have the face of the anvil, which of course is used for your general forging, hammer, drawing out, squaring out, all that. Now the two main parts back here on this anvil are the hardy hole. And this is where you can bend heavier steel stock here, or actually there's some special tools that go in here, such as the hardy tool. Now the hardy tool is nothing more than just a large chisel tool that goes into the hole of the hardy. And again, these hardy holes come in different sizes here, and this particular hardy has a tapered end, so it's kind of universal. But these are actually, every anvil has a different size here, and they always usually would come with these tools. And finally, back here, we have what's called a pitrel hole. And this is used for punching holes in flat stock steel. And I'll go over that here in just a little bit. But these again, you can bend smaller lightweight pieces of steel in here. But it's primarily used for punching with a punch. So, and now another tool I'm going to talk about here that is found in almost every smith shop is called the post vise. Post vises are a mainstay in every blacksmith shop. Now what sets the post vise apart from a regular bench vise is that it has this long steel leg here. They're also known as a leg vise. Now these are primarily set up on a post or on a bench, and the end here has this very neat little collar with a taper on it. And what you do here, how these are supposed to be set up, is you would set them, you know, you'd find your post, whatever, set it up. And then in the ground, you would set in like a metal socket so that when you go to set this up, that collar is sitting right on top of the socket in the ground. And these vices can take way more hammering than a normal bench vise could. So that's the history of the leg vise. So now we're going to talk a little bit about blacksmith's tongs. So blacksmith tongs come in a wide variety of shapes and styles. Some of them are your basic flat jaws here, which are primarily, these are considered universal. They're used for just about everything from holding square stock, like this here, like that, or they're actually much nicer for holding flat stock. And then we have here what are called bolt tongs. Now these have the opening in here so we can grab a hold of something that was to have an end on it, like say a bolt or a spike, like a railroad spike or something like that. And with the end here, these are really handy for, again, grabbing square stock, or we could grab a hold of, you can grab a hold of some round stock. They do just as nice of a job there. Many smiths actually prefer to use these tongs over any other type of tong. So then we have pickup tongs. These little guys don't normally get used for anything real heavy and extensive, except if you have a piece of steel in the fire. If I was to work with something hot and heavy here, I'd heat this up first, and say I had to move it around in the fire, all I'm gonna do is just simply pick this up, check it out, say, okay, it's hot, it's not hot enough, it goes back in there, and then just keep doing that little number. So, then, now, tongs could be made for special jobs, depending on what the smith was working with. And one set I have here to show are wagon tire tongs. Now these, unfortunately, do not get a lot of use nowadays because, unfortunately, the days of the horse and buggy are long gone. But how they're designed is you have the arches here that would grab around the wagon band or the tire of the wagon, and the smith would use them, hold them, manipulate them, bring them over to the forge and do all that. So these are actually, unfortunately, as I said, they're not going to be used as much these days. They're more or less something as like a collector's item, but they're still interesting to give you a glimpse of how a smith would make a certain tool for a certain job. Now, again, focusing back on hardy tools here, this is the most common type you're going to find. These here are used for cutting steel stock, and these come in all different shapes and sizes. There's some hardy tools that are actually meant for bending steel around. Some, like these here, are meant for cutting steel. Some of them are used for drawing steel out thinner, heavier, whichever ore. And I will show you all that very shortly here as well, how this works. So anyways, hammers have changed little over the years with smithing, but we primarily have a few different types that are commonly used. Here we have the crosspeen hammer. This is the universal all-around blacksmith's hammer you're gonna find in every shop. And how this guy works is we have the regular striking face here, you know, for doing your hammering out, drawing out, whatever. And then we have the crosspeen end. This end here is used primarily this way, and we would take our steel stock, and you'd heat it up, and then you would actually bring it here, and you would strike it, and it draws the steel out, making it longer, thinner, whatever you would need. So then we have the ball peen hammer, also known as the machinist hammer. It's a primary hammer in the shop, but it's not really useful for a lot of stuff other than basic striking. But the ball end here is used for riveting. And a prime example of that is when you're making a set of tongs and you have your rivet set in place, you would come here and there's a rivet, this little rivet end right here. You would take, heat the rivet up, place it through here, and then you take the ball peen and you would strike around the rivet until it is formed over to what you would be looking for in a rivet head. So, and then another common hammer that's found in most smith shops is a rounding hammer. Again, this is, you can use these for general forging when you use the flat end, but the round end is good for making like spoons or anything that has a dish shape to it. These are also used by farriers a lot for shaping and forming horseshoes. But I generally use it for making dishes for candle holders or other such items like that. So now what I'm gonna show you all are chisels and punches. So here we have the center punch. So if I was to make and drift a hole in a piece of flat stock, what I would do is simply take, oh, here it is. I would simply come here and take my chisel punch here, and with my hammer, come right here and then just strike that smart, and it has left a nice little indentation right there. So I know when I go to put this in the fire where I'm gonna be punching with the drift punch. Because if I was to use this, if I was to do this with say a piece of soapstone, which you would normally use to mark your metal, it's gonna burn up in the fire and you're not gonna see it. So that's what the chisel, the center punch is for. And then we have the regular chisel, which these are primarily used for putting textures and details on certain items, such as these hooks here. You can see how these hooks have leaf details on them. And what I did here a while back was I made these hooks with these leaf textures. And all I do here is when the metal is hot, I place the chisel on here and I strike it, move over, strike it, strike it, strike it, strike it. And then I come here on an angle and I do this little number, and that's how you get the leaf textures on there. So, and then the main punch that I would be using for drifting holes is the drift punch. And all we do here is we get our stock hot, and then we come over here to the pitcher hole in the anvil, and then we drive the hole through our flat stock. And I'll show you all that in a little while here. So now I gave you all a little introduction, just a few of the tools in the smith shop. Now I want to go over some techniques that are used by the smiths. So the most common technique we're going to use that is used in the smith shop is called drawing out. So say I want to take this piece of half inch square rod and draw it out to a much smaller size. Well, okay, if you hammer this cold, it would take forever to get this to where we want it. Whereas with the heat of the forge, that's gonna make this metal much softer so we can draw it out much faster. So I'm gonna place this in the fire. And by working the blower here, we're going to get this metal hot. And one trick that's actually useful when doing this is to actually bury your steel sock. So now we're gonna heat this up. And when working with the thicker, heavier pieces of steel like this, heavier steel requires more heat, where thinner pieces of steel require less heat. So this half inch piece of square stock, it's gonna take a little, not a whole lot of time, but just a little bit of time to make it hot, to get it hot and ready to where we're gonna have to make it ready to use it. Okay, we're gonna check this here quick, and if it's ready, we're gonna go right to the anvil. Yep, that's good. All right, so now when I grab the hammer, I'm not gonna lay my thumb on top because that's gonna lead to a lot of pain later on in life. So we're gonna do this here. Okay, so what you can see here, what I just did is we went from half inch to roughly about 3/8. Now it's obviously not really round and pretty, but with a little tweaking, we can make it a lot prettier. So that's drawing out, and it actually is incorporating rounding as well. Now you could do the same thing with square stock to make it round, or round stock to square. So that's that. And that's just cooling it off right there for you. So this is still gonna be a little warm because obviously the heavier the steel stock, the more heat it's gonna absorb, and it's gonna take a little bit longer to cool down. So we're just gonna let that cool off in the bucket there. So now what I wanna cover is twisting. And that's a very cool technique that is used, that I have used here for this particular wall hook. And this is what's done right here, as well as on this S hook here. It's this here, it's only used for decorative purposes, but from what I understand, it's how they used to make wood boring bits for working with wood. So now twisting, what we're gonna utilize here is a piece of square stock, but I'm gonna cut this down. So we're gonna show you how I use the hardy tool. So first thing is we're gonna place the hardy in the hardy hole here. And that's how they sit, right in the square, like so, but we're actually gonna carry it over here. So these sit right here. And when cutting with the hardy, one thing you want to keep in mind is your steel has to be at a yellow bright heat. Can't, you know, red heat, it'll take forever to cut through. So we're going to bring this up to a higher heat. So, all right, so that's where we want to be. And this is how you use the hardy cutter. So first you strike it once. Strike it twice, and you just keep going around, and you follow the little channel that's going on right there. You can see I only have a little piece of steel holding onto it, so one more strike here. And that's just about ready to come off of there, so I'm gonna grab my other set of tongs here, and we're gonna break that right off. That's how you would cut off steel. Now, with this little piece here, I'm gonna make for you all one of these drive hooks. This was pretty much a staple on every early farmstead. And how these work is, you would, you know, it's got the point on here, very similar to what you would find on nail. And you'd come over here, you'd set it up on here, and you'd drive it into the board. So this is going to involve drawing out and a couple of techniques, like such as curling, and then to put a neat finish on it, we're going to blacken the steel. All right. Okay, so you can see I got the taper started, but I want to actually come back just a little bit more here. So I'm going to heat this up one more time and draw this taper out some more, and then I'll work on the hook end. And one thing when using tongs to hold the shorter piece of stock is you want to make sure they get a real good grip, because otherwise this will come flying out and it's not going to be pretty when that happens. So now, okay, so now our point is more drawn out, so it should go into the wood a whole lot easier. Now we're going to flip this over and draw this out some more, and then we'll do the hook and throw a twist in there. Right, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to work on drawing this out more. So we're going to come back over here. Okay. So now what I got going on here is a little bit of my mistake here. This is rounded off and that's still square. So I'm just going to work on this section here. I'm going to draw it out still, but I'm going to grab it from this side and try to make this more uniform. Okay, so now what I'm going to do next is I'm going to work on making my 90, twisting it, and then putting the curl in it. Okay, so as I said earlier, when we're going to put a bend, we're going to use the horn of the anvil here. So we're just going to So now I got my bend in here, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to place this back in the fire quickly, and then work on putting the second bend in here. And then we'll do the curl. So actually I'm going to draw this out just a little bit more, just to give me some more material to work with. Okay. So now to isolate this so that this all doesn't go out on me, I'm going to cool this, but I'm going to make a sharp 90 first, cool it, and then come back to it. Okay, so we have her 90. Into the bucket she goes. Because this way here, this isn't going to bend on us. So now, we're just going to simply work. So there is our hook. Now, if I wanted to, I could actually heat just this end up and put a neat little twist in it, but I'm going to leave it alone. And what I'm going to work on is up in here, I'm going to put a twist in there just for looks. So you'll see all that in just a moment. So carry it over here to my vise attachment. And now when it's softer like this, this is way easier to do than if it was cold. So now I'm going to check this out and see how it looks. And that looks pretty good to me. Now obviously the hook kind of went out of alignment, so I'll just quickly here hammer this straight and flat, and then we're going to do a blackened finish, and I will show you all that in just a moment. There's many different things that people like to use for putting a finish on steel. Most people can actually take a brass brush and it'll give it a gold finish, which I don't have a brass brush out here today. Some folks will actually take beeswax and use that for a finish, but what I like to use is something I call black magic. And that is actually nothing more than used motor oil that, for all of you out there who change your own oil, whether it's on your mower, your tractor, your car, I never throw this stuff out. I always keep it on hand. It's actually, used motor oil is very handy for tempering knife blades, tool steel, and for putting a blackened finish on steel. And what you'll need when you're putting the blacksmith's finish on here is oil-soaked rag, and then you're gonna need a dry clean rag, because once you put the oil on there, it'll still be a little wet, so you'll want the dry rag just to wipe it off, and it will still have its blackened finish. When you're blackening steel, you don't want it very hot, because otherwise it can fireball, and it's not a very safe experience. So we're just gonna go ahead and get this hot. We're just gonna gently crank on the blower here, let it do its thing. Okay, so with the glove hand, I'm gonna grab it with the rag, and this will smoke a little bit. Not too bad, but it will smoke up on us. And you can roughly see we're starting to get our soot finish on here as we're wiping the oil on here. So just so I can get the other side better where that spike is, I'm just gonna go ahead and pick that up once and then wipe this down a little bit. And then again, we're just gonna wipe it down with a dry rag. Now, another point I wanna throw out here is when you're doing this, obviously this is gonna be a little warm, so we wanna let that sit and cool off to the side here. So best place to do that is either on your anvil face, or what I like to do sometimes is I keep 12x12 patio paper block right by my forge or my anvil so I can let that cool down. But anyways, folks, what we have here is our drive hook. And again, how this is made, we drew it out, we put the twist in it, we put the curl in it, and of course how these are fastened in is you simply put it up there and you drive it in with a hammer. Now, prior to the drill press that most people have, punching was the most common way of putting a hole in the piece of steel. And then of course, by the early 1900s, late 1800s, somewhere in there, we started having drill presses were starting to become a more popular thing. So really this method isn't used a whole lot nowadays, but I'll just show you how to do this just for a more traditional method. So we want to get this really hot. All right, so we got our stock hot. And now what I want to do is just wire brush it down quick so I can see where our mark is, which is right there. So now we're going to come over here and place our mark over the pitcher hole. And I'm going to just keep going over this. And what's important when doing this is you want to take your punch out of here as often as possible, or else it'll get too soft and it'll lose its hardness. So we just keep coming here. And one more sharp strike. Okay, so what we're gonna see here is we've actually gone through. So I'm gonna heat this up one more time and we'll get that hole drifted out, punched out nicer, and it'll look a whole lot better. Okay, so where I was trying to fish the hole out here, so I got it back here, and I'm gonna use a slightly smaller punch here, And when you get these smaller punches, it's actually kind of handy to use a pair of tongs to hold them like that. I could hold them in my hand, but it's not going to be very efficient to do. So we're just going to do that little number there. And then we will just work on getting that out. And what you'll often find when you quench or cool hot metal is it'll develop flash rust. And that's actually pretty easy to get rid of. All you do is you simply take your wire brush and you just give it a couple of passes with that. Just wipe it down once and that gets rid of it. So, folks, I want to thank you all for joining me here today at the Matthews Farm over here in Galax, and I hope you all would come out and visit us sometime. And remember, stay safe, and we'll see you all next time.